Hello friends, welcome to E-Pathshala. My name is Arjinder Kaur and I teach in the Department of Political Science in Postgraduate Government College Sector 11 Chandigarh. Through this module, we will try and learn what post-colonialism means. This concept has made a very late entry, like many other concepts, into the realm of international relations theory and politics. Amongst many theorists, this concept has not been received the way it has been received nowadays. This concept has not gained much importance of late, but now theorists have come to the conclusion that post-colonialism is an important concept to be studied. What post-colonialism in general term means is that we have to look at the life of the colonized people from the point of view of the colonized people themselves, rather than looking at them from the people who were colonizing these people. According to the post-colonial theory, it is very important to understand the economic, cultural, social aspects and the relationship of these concepts between the colonizer and the colonized. Hence, post-colonialism has become a very important concept, and we need to understand what post-colonialism means. And through this module, we will be looking at the meaning, nature and the concept's importance in the realm of international relations theory and politics. Explanatory theories and alternative theories. Explanatory or problem-solving theories. 1. These theories are positivist theories. 2. Positivist theories believe in the separation of the physical or the natural world from that of the social world. Critical or alternative theories. 1. These theories are post-positivist theories. 2. These theories reject such a separation. And 3. Their concern is to uncover regularities in human behavior. They see the world as something external to theories about it and thereby explain social world in much the same way as a natural scientist might explain the physical world. Alternative theories. And 3. Their concern is that the theories about the world shape how we act and view the world. Theories are not external to things. They are trying to explain and instead may construct how we think about the world. Theorists are understood to be part of the theories they try to understand. Examples include realism, liberalism, and some strands of Marxism. Alternative theories. Examples include feminism, Gramscian approaches, post-colonialism. Post-colonialism. Post-colonialism focuses on colonial forms of power and the continuing dominance of race and cultural hierarchies in world politics. Both its proponents and critics have differing conceptions of what post-colonialism is or its definition. While the proponents argue that the unbroken term post-colonialism is more sensitive to the long history of colonial consequences, some of its critics invoke the hyphenated form post-colonialism as a decisive temporal marker of the decolonizing process. Still others maintain that it implies chronological separation between colonialism and its aftermath, on the grounds that post-colonial condition is inaugurated with the onset rather than the end of colonial occupation, where the condition can be referred to as post-coloniality and the theory that deals with the conditions as post-colonialism. Chakravarti Spivak maintains that we live in a post-colonial, neo-colonized world, while Homi Bhabha regards post-coloniality as a salutary reminder of the persistent neo-colonial relations within the New World Order and the multinational division of labor. In short, colonialism as conventionally defined in terms of formal settlement and control of other people's land and goods is generally over, but many of its structures and relations of power are still in place. The post in post-colonialism is not therefore to be understood as a clearly dividing temporal post, but rather as an indication of continuity. Post-colonialism in international relations studies. Post-colonial theory largely focuses on the experiences of non-Western societies and questions the implicit universalistic claims of Western knowledge and experiences as representative for human nature and all of mankind. Especially in the discipline of international relations, they argue Eurocentricism has been the force that single-handedly and inevitably shaped the discourse. Post-colonial theorists maintain that through its imperialistic and colonizing past, the West created and shaped the world in its own image. by claiming superiority of the European experience and the development and history of the European continent, the modern nation-state system that undergirds the world of international relations is taken as a pre-given determined fact rather than a socially constituted system which emerged under extreme colonial violence both internally within Europe and with respect to the colonies. Armed with the sole claim to reason and scientific understanding, the West, they labeled the rest as native, heathen, uncivilized and irrational, as opposed to the white European male who saw himself as a man, Christian, civilized and rational. The images of the Occident and the Orient as two opposing systems of thought and ideas are reproduced by the Eurocentric bias in scientific research. Literature, history, philosophy and anthropology were all used to remake distinctively European experiences. Regional Europe became global and universal, and non-Western cultures, arts and sciences were degraded to folklore, myths and shamanism. According to post-colonial theorists, language plays an important role in the West, establishing its power relations, often the binary us versus them, such as the clash of civilizations, is, they argue, a restatement of colonial relations. This kind of othering plays a key role in formulating practices in the international arena. Post-colonial theorists following the French philosopher Michel Foucault try to uncover the power relations that lie beneath these practices, or what they call discourses. The way practices are thought and spoken about through speech and writing to expose them as scientific to Western culture and not universal. Post-colonial scholars argue that a singular focus on class or capitalist political economy as advocated by many Marxists is not adequate, but the importance of culture and identity is stressed with an equally, if not more important, emphasis placed on race, ethnicity, gender, religion and other markers of cultural identity. Post-colonialism deals with these cultural themes because they believe even though some approaches deal with one aspect, they leave out the other, like Marxist theories may not adequately deal with gender, and even if they do, it may remain Eurocentric or drawing from Western feminism. Hence, the major implications of post-colonialism in international relations studies are issues of race, ethnicity, identity, gender, class, power, discourse, exploitation, oppression, and politics of what is defined as knowledge, while providing a challenge to the first worldism. The post-colonialist thinkers problematize what they see as the dominant way in which the history of international relations is constructed in Western terms and has been used to justify imperialism and war. They also address the way in which Western nation states try to reform developing nations in the exact same image as they, in a manner similar to the one used during the height of the colonial empires, that is, as a white man's burden. According to post-colonial theorists, contemporary international relations cannot be understood without examining what one scholar calls the colonial science of global politics. Methodologically, many of them use Foucault's genealogical approach, which draws attention to the undetected and invisible power that propels some concepts into prominence while muting some concepts or themes in international relations studies. These scholars address various inequalities and silences within international relations. They explore the power relations that govern international relations ways of representing the world, where colonial practices have given rise to exploitation, alienation, and repression. Edward Said, in his Orientalism, plots out different dimensions of power that shape how the non-West or the Orient is understood by the West. Oliver Dadow argues that the four most prominent ones are 1. The power political, the establishment of colonial structures for governing foreign territories. 2. Power intellectuals, the subjection of the Orient to study linguistics, historians, scientists, and so on. 3. Power cultural, orthodoxies, canons of taste, texts, and values. 4. Power moral, ideas about who we and they are, as well as how we and they think. Post-colonial international relations scholars also draw inspiration from Franz Fanon, who deals with the role of class, race, national culture, and violence, and the deep psychological effect of colonization on the colonized. More recently, the ideas and writings of M.K. Gandhi have also played an influential role in thinking about how colonial violence cannot be separated from modern Western ideas, and that modern Western civilization itself is deeply flawed because its way of looking at the world and itself has been inherently colonizing. Three movements in post-colonial scholarship. Philip Darby and Albert Paolini discuss three overlapping but nevertheless distinct movements in post-colonial scholarship that are useful to study of IR. First movement, originated in the study of Third World fiction and interrogated representational practices in the service of colonialism, where colonialism signifies a continuing set of practices that are seen to prescribe relations between the West and the Third World beyond the independence of the former colonies. Second movement. The second movement constituted a focus on the projects of resistance and recovery, highlighted the works of Memmi and Fanon, among others. Third movement. The third movement in post-colonial studies constituted one world movement, according to Gandhi, which engages with the post-colonial desire for extra or post-national solidarities and considers concepts and terms such as hybridity and diaspora, which have come to characterize mixed or globalized culture. Post-colonialism's apparent inability to offer a systemic and well-bounded theoretical alternative to mainstream international relations theorize is the primary source of criticism against it. Post-colonialists respond by pointing out that their objective is precisely to move away from these well-defined and abstract theories and focus on the fragments, the world of experience, the everyday, the personal, which, like the feminists they say, is also political, tell stories and engage in a relentless and continuing critique of dominant paradigms. Post-colonial scholars argue this is the spirit of their research, and not to formulate abstract theories that appear to be scientifically objective but are in reality entirely subjective. Arif Derlik and Ejaz Ahmed, among others, have criticized post-colonial intellectuals for opportunistically making a career out of marginality and speaking on behalf of those who cannot speak. Various scholars within international relations have drawn insights from post-colonial theory to construct a growing body of literature that can be identified as post-colonial international relations scholarship. However, scholars have emphasized different aspects in their works. For instance, Sankaran Krishna highlights the importance of race in international relations. His main argument is that there has been a willful amnesia on the issue of race in constituting the discipline of international relations itself. The history of the world, he says, has been distorted in its depictions since the so-called discovery of the New World by Christopher Columbus. The West, through an extension of the idea of enlightenment, also constituted the pillars of international relations studies in the post-Columbian era through devices like sovereignty, territoriality, nation-state, security, and international law. According to him, these abstract ideas are primarily constituted as a tool aimed at advising colonial masters on the requirement to maintain peace and conflict prevention between European sovereign states in the light of expanding colonies and greater scramble for land and resources. Thus, while mainstream IR characterized the 19th century world as the 100 years peace maintained by the concert of Europe, he provides a counterpoint in the fact that the emergence of the modern territorially defined state system in Europe was coterminous with and in this dissociable form the genocide of the indigenous people of the New World, the enslavement of the natives of the African continent, and colonization of the societies of Asia. Extending his argument, he maintains that international theory's tendency is to describe the world only in terms of the categories of the West constructs with reference only to those limited materials. Siba Grovogui focuses on Western power and its implications in defining universal international practices such as international law. He talks about the West's projecting their ideas as universal values, while in reality they engaged in very parochial politics in which only Europe and its ideas mattered. He questions the mainstream account of the history of the Westphalian system, a founding pillar of international relations. He argues that conventional theories falsely perceive the Westphalian system and the underlying principle of territorial sovereignty to be universal despite its European roots. The Westphalian common sense, according to him, has become so dominant that instead of treating deviations, particularly in post-colonial Africa, as evidence undermining the universalism of the Westphalian system, they are seen as proof that deviating states cannot live up to the demands of sovereignty. He then argues that international law does not stem from ethical considerations on how to create a universal order, but on how a small group of European states could achieve hegemony. The Westphalian system has in a similar way come to be seen as natural, a transcendent form of regime that has become idealized in academia. However, as states in Europe, weak or strong, were given sovereignty, the same regime was denied to the people of Africa. In Africa, other rules applied, as evident in the outcome of Berlin Conference of 1884, the resultant colonial scramble for Africa. For example, in analyzing the colonization of Congo, Grovogui recounts that a small and insignificant Belgium, or rather its king Leopold II, could take control over the vast and rich Congo. The incoherent and loosely put together states of Belgium and Switzerland could not have survived if it were not for other Western powers. There is nothing essential about the so-called Westphalian common sense. Therefore, any claim that the failure of African states is due to a deviation from the Westphalian system is not only a flaw but false. In other words, the native was efficiently denied to possess will, conscience or agency. According to Grovogui and other post-colonial scholars, this native essentialism is implicitly present in Eurocentric theories and needs to be challenged. According to Grovogui, post-colonialism treats truth and knowledge as something that can never fully depict how an event unfolded. What is said to be is never a full account of events. The gap between what is said and what has happened can only be understood if imperial and colonial structures are revealed and examined. As has been observed, for example, by Edward Said, these observations were solely European and excluded native concerns or knowledge. Said also illustrated how these stereotypical observations of the other in the Orient were culturally institutionalized by the colonizers and used as the basis of Europe's policies towards the Orient, and how these ideas have continued to influence policy both in the West and among the formerly colonized. Himadeep Muppidi focuses on what the discipline and practice of international relations conceals. He believes it is devoid of a concern for humanity. He states that as a result of an unflinching desire by conventional theories to be precise and objective, the colonial past and its legacies are forgotten, ignored, or reimagined in ways that obscure its human cost. Tracing the colonial forms of knowledge and their influence on modern nations and concepts of international relations, Muppidi goes beyond these limited notions to examine how issues in global politics are communicated, for instance, in the press. He states that by selectively focusing on the continuous imagining and reimagining of binaries of the self and the other, much of conventional international relations theory and practice is constructed and circulated predominantly as a threat from the other to the self. Muppidi finds that the only solution to the uneven and asymmetric relationship in which the colonized have been destroyed in mass more times and in greater magnitude than their colonizer is to adopt an approach which is anti-colonial and acknowledges the diversity of humanity within the field of international relations. David Blandley and Naeem Inayatullah, while not self-confessedly post-colonial scholars, deal with many post-colonial themes within international relations, and their book International Relations and the Problem of Difference has been path-breaking in this regard. They focus on the way idea of difference has been treated as central to international relations in the way inside-outside or national-international has been constituted since Westphalia. According to them, the suppression of difference or diversity within European societies that was taking place with the intolerant and bloody religious wars between Catholics and Protestants during the emergence of the Westphalian system of nation-states led to the creation of a homogeneous European inside self versus an external non-European other that was increasingly viewed as suspicious and threatening. The creation of what they call empires of uniformity, homogeneous nation-states, internally in Europe was crucial to understanding colonial empire building, externally which was premised on annihilating or wiping out differences or diversity in the colonies and westernizing the natives either through religious conversions to Catholicism, such as in the early Spanish conquest of Americans, or the more secular British civilizing mission in India to make Indians more modern, that is English. By means of conclusion, thus we can say that post-colonialism does not only mean to represent the story of the other, but post-colonialism is also an important concept to understand what it means by power relations. It also critiques the hegemony that has been created by the colonized, by the colonizers themselves, and how they have been imposing their way of looking at things and how that has been grasped by the people who have been colonized. Thus, it is important to understand that it is not only the viewpoint of the colonizers, but it is also the viewpoint of the colonized people that matters when it comes to understand the relationship between the two. And through this module, we have understood that post-colonialism does not only represent the story of the other, but it also tells what and how the colonizers have been trying to create their hegemony in terms of representing their representing the truth. Also, it highlights the fact that post-colonialism does not only fixes its importance from the point of view of the colonizers, but it also suggests that there are multiple truths and there have been multiple ways of looking at the relationship between the colonized and the colonizers. Thank you.